إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وإنما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى وما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين شعبان is getting close to its mid of Sha'ban. We started in our last khutbah talking about what we needed the most in order to prepare for the month of Ramadan. And we started talking about Al-Qur'an while getting ready to accept and meet the month of the Qur'an. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. We started talking about the فضل of the Quran and how the Quran was a unique miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which has been different than any other miracle for the prophets before. Because every other miracle that came to the previous prophets before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a miracle that was witnessed by the people of his time. When we are talking about the stick of Musa or the miracles of Sayyidina Isa or the miracle of the camel for Sayyidina Saleh, it has been witnessed by the people of his time. But the miracle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been a miracle that will be for his people and all people that come after him until the Day of Judgment. And that the other unique thing is that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his message is his miracle. His message is not disassociated from the miracles that came to him. It's his miracle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this miracle is challenging the ins and the jinn to come up with something similar to it or even ayah from it. Even if they come together to try to do that, they will not be able to. And this is a challenge that will stay until the Day of Judgment. It's a miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting from any kind of alterations until the Day of Judgment. This miracle is between our hands and on the shelves in our houses accumulating dust the whole year. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمْ رَبْ And we tend to open it more and the most in the month of Ramadan. While those who really know and are wise enough will be opening this miracle every day to get the best out of it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying Alif Lam Mim. In every letter you read from the Quran, you get a reward from that. And the reward is multiplied 10 times. And Alif Lam Mim, when it's not one letter, it's three letters. Alif Harf, Wa Lam Harf, Wa Mim Harf. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is 19 harf, this is 190. And when you read one juz in Qur'an, it's more than 220,000 hasana that you get by reading the Qur'an for 30 or 40 minutes. And some who are good can do it in 20 minutes. 220,000 hasana that you come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment, hoping for a hasana to come into your scale to make it heavier. One hasana will make it heavier. You have a chance to get 220,000 hasana and more every day by reading one juz. You're not there yet, start with whatever you can, but start being consistent with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a certain word every day. Certain word every day. Get the best out of this blessing. It's from Allah's generosity. He's giving us this chance. And only the wise ones will take the chance. We said that when you come in front of, on the Day of Judgment, at the door of Jannah, your level is in Jannah is decided according to how far you will be reading. The Prophet ﷺ said that you will be told, اقرأ وارتقي ورتل كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا فإن منزلتك عند آخر آية تقرأها. Read and ascend and rattle as you were doing in dunya. Your level in Jannah will be at the last ayah you will be reading. So how much you need to reach in the levels of Jannah? The ulama is saying that the levels of Jannah is equivalent to the number of ayat of the Quran. And each level between each one and the other is like between the earth and heaven. ما بين السماء والأرض. This is one level. How far you want to reach. This is the miracle that you have between your hands. And this is what you can do in order to get the best out of it. This is what we'll be discussing today. What is our duties toward the Quran? What do we need to do? First, you have to have a certain word every day. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking him, O Prophet of Allah, how much I need to read from the Quran? He said, read it in 30 days. This is where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started. This is your minimum, 30 days. Finish it every 30 days. So he said, I can do more than that. He's negotiating with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he can do better. Not less, better. So he reached that you can read it in 7 days, in 10 days, and then 7 days. And then he said, I can do more than that. He wants to use his time and his power as a young Muslim to dedicate it to the Quran. He said, read it in 3 days, and no one can comprehend if he read it in less than that. This is not a one-time reading. This is a consistent reading. When you commit with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, always be in increase, not in a decrease. One of the Sahaba, they found him one day crying. They asked him, why are you crying? He said, I missed my word from yesterday. And it must be because of the sin I have committed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me miss it. And this was a good enough reason for him to cry. To miss his word one day, it must be because of something between him and Allah went wrong. So this is the first duty you need to have towards the Quran. Have a fixed word that you have in the Quran every day. And get this a commitment for the rest of your life. Always be in increase, never in decrease. Never in decrease. Start even with one page, then one rubah, then one hizb, then one juz. And if you can do more, it's all in your scale. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplies for whatever He wants. The second duty we have toward the Quran is ta'allum qira'at al-Quran. You have to know how to read the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in Surah Al-Qamar, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for us, for those who want to really learn. You make it easy. Only your nafs, the bad part of your nafs, or the shaitan will make it look hard for you. It's so hard, I cannot really do it well. Just have the intention and go for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promising to make it easy. For those who has the Arab language as a mother tongue, you don't have an excuse. It's a blessing you have. The Qur'an have came in your language. For those who are non-Arabs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best example to see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for whoever he wants, who has the right intention. You will see a lot of those non-Arabs are reading the Qur'an even better than those who have the Arabic as a mother tongue. And make you feel ashamed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give the reward according to the effort and the intention that you're trying. Just make the intention and go for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy for you. There is no excuse. If Allah promised you this, Allah will fulfill. He never fails a promise. Just make the intention and go for it. Imagine you're reading the Quran as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have read it. With the mudud, with the hunan, with the qalqala that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been doing it. With how Jibreel brought it to him and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it to Jibreel. You have this chance to read the Quran as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have read it to Jibreel. And Allah will make it easy for you. Just have the intention and go for it. يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام خيركم أو أفضلكم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. The best out of you who learn the Quran and teach it. Learn it with the intention that you are going to be spreading this knowledge. You will teach your kids. You will teach your wife. You will teach your immediate ones and whoever you can teach. So you learn it first. So that you read it according to how the Prophet ﷺ was saying it and try to spread this knowledge. This is makes you among the best. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام الماهر بالقرآن مع السفرة الكرام البرع والذي يقرأ القرآن ويتتعتع فيه هو عليه شاق له أجران. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, those who are good in reading the Qur'an, they are proficient in the Qur'an. They are among the angels who are the best of the angels, the carriers of the Qur'an. The Prophet is saying, the comparison is both of them are carriers of the Qur'an. The one who is proficient in the Qur'an and the angels are carrying it. And those who are reading the Qur'an and they are having it hard, they are getting double the reward. The reward of reading the Quran and the hardship that they are having to try to achieve better and better in reading it. This doesn't make the second group better than the first. The first is among the angels. This is the level they are in. But the second group is getting double the reward by trying and trying and trying with the hope that they would get better and better in reading. يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام أيكم يحب أن يخدو كل يوم إلى بطحان أو العقيق فيأتي منه بناقتين كوامين زهروين في غير إثم ولا قطع رحم فلئن يخدو أحدكم إلى المسجد فيتعلم أو يقرأ آيتين من كتاب الله خير له من ناقتين وثلاث خير له من ثلاث وأربع خير له من أربع ومن أعدادهن من الإبل. The Prophet is saying, who among you, telling his companion, who among you want to go to Batan or Aqib? These are two valleys that were close to Al-Madinah, around 2-3 miles from Al-Madinah, that were known to have the trading of the camels. So who want to go to Batan or Al-Aqib and get two camels and come back without any fighting with anyone, without cutting any relation, without any problems? Just go and bring them back. Who want to do that? whoever go to the masjid and try to learn two ayah or read two ayah is better than bringing two camels. The Prophet ﷺ is saying, trying to give an example of comparing to khayr al-dunya and the khayr al-akhir. The best you get from dunya, at his time, this is the naqa, naqatayn. Going to the masjid and learning two ayah from the Quran is better than that. And three ayat is better than three camels. And four is better than four, and more like that. And then he said, وَأَعْدَادِهِنَّ مِنَ الْإِبِلِ, and equal to that from the males of the camels. So from the females and then the males, equal to that. The ayat is better. This is what you get when you are looking to what the rewards you get from al-akhirah compared to anything you get from the dunya. The third duty we have toward the Quran, التأثر عند قراءة القرآن. You get affected. Your heart get moved when you read the Quran. Imam Ghazali was saying, there is two positions or two situations when your heart will get moved. You'll have the reverence in your heart. When you listen to the Quran and when the death is mentioned. If you are not affected in these two situations, go look for a heart, as you don't have a heart. اذهب فابحث عن قلب فليس لك قلب. Are we having this reverence in our heart when we listen to the Quran? Do we get affected? Does the ayat make a difference for us? Do we attend to whatever is said when you are listening to an imam or a sheikh reading the Quran? Or when you are reading it yourself? When you listen to ayat al-adab, you get affected. Oh Allah, protect me from al-adab. When you are listening to ayat of al-jannah, you are hoping to get into Jannah. When you listen to Ya Ayyuha Alladina Amanu, listen attentively what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to tell me. When you listen to those who are Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned will be tortured in hellfire, al-kafirun, you ask Allah to seek Allah's refuge from being among those, or among the munafiqeen who are in the lowest levels of hellfire. Are you like that when you listen to the Quran? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have gave the excuse for the rock. And he didn't give the excuse for those who have these hard hearts. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى ثم قست قلوبكم فهي كالحجارة أو أشد قسوة فإن من الحجارة لما يتفجر منه الأنهار وإن منها لما يشقق فيخرج منه الماء وإن منها لما يهبط من خشية الله وما الله بغافل عما تعمل. Your hearts became hard, so it became like rocks or even harder. As rocks, rivers comes out of them. And they get cracks that water comes out of it. Or they go down from the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But those hard hearts doesn't have this. There is nothing that will soften your heart like making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reading the Quran and reading the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more and more you do that, the more and more your hearts will get softened. Sayyidina Abu Bakr, when Jama'a min al-Yaman, people from Yemen came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and listened to the Quran, they started crying. Sayyidina Abu Bakr was saying, we were like that before our hearts became hard. Sayyidina Abu Bakr was saying that. The one who, when he was praying with people and leading the people in the salah, they will not hear the Quran from how much he was crying, by affected by the Quran. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was saying, when they meet each other, him and the companions in the streets, and remind each other with the ayah, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Isn't it the time for those who believe to have their heart have a reverence for the remembrance of Allah. They will sit down in the street and start crying from how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blaming them for how hard their hearts became. This is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and the companions. Where are we from that? Do we get our hearts affected at all by reading or listening to the Quran? This is a commitment we have to have towards the Quran. Prepare as much as you want for Ramadan. If your heart is not there, you are losing it. And this is what we need to prepare from now. Get ourselves ready to the Quran by getting our heart ready. Work on your heart. When you are in the middle of Ramadan, still work on your heart. It's too late. You are missing a lot. If your heart is not there already, you are missing a lot. It's the time now to get ready for that. فَلَمْ يَأْنِ الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا أَنْ تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Isn't it the time for us to get our hearts, have reverence for the remembrance of Allah? If not now, then when? If you really want to get the best out of this coming Ramadan and make it the best Ramadan that ever passed on you, get your heart ready before you reach the first day of Ramadan. Start from now, from today, if you didn't start already. Ubadah ibn Samit one day was standing to protect the army of the Muslims. And Ammar ibn Yasir was laying down, they were shifting with each other, laying down while he had his shift time to come. And he started praying. One of them, al-Kuffar, threw an arrow into him. It fell into his shoulder. He took it out and continued reading. And then he threw another arrow. It fell into him again, took it out and continued reading. He did it for a third time. Until he couldn't stand it. So he took it out and finished his salah and woke up Ammar ibn Yasir. So Ammar ibn Yasir saw his status. Why did you wake me up from the first hour? He said, I was in the middle of ayah that my soul will leave my body will be better for me than to leave reading it. This is how far his heart is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab one day was passing and he heard the ayah Inna adhaba rabbika lawaqa ma lahu min dafa. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab was passing and he heard the ayah that the torture of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is gonna happen. There is nothing will push it back. He fell unconscious by how hard it hit his heart. And he stayed like that for a month. The ayah had penetrated his heart. Not getting affected by the ayah penetrated his heart. This is how far we need to work on our hearts to be affected by the Quran. And let's use this time and start from now. The habit takes 40 days to become something that will be a habit. You need to work on it for 40 days consistently so that it will be a habit. Start from now and use Ramadan. And the shayateen are not there so that you will be continuing to be there. All the environment is ready for you to continue on your habit. By the end of Ramadan, it's already something instilled. I'm already have my commitment with the Quran. This is how I listen and attend to the Quran. This is how I'm getting affected to the Quran. And stays with you after Ramadan. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي لكم فاستغفروه إنه غفور رحيم. إن الحمد لله. اللهم لك الحمد حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه. The fourth duty we have towards the Quran is tadabbur al-Quran. You have to try your best to understand the meaning of al-ayat. You can start with reading the tafsir, whether it's English or Arabic, tafsir of the Quran. And start with something simple. Just the tafsir al-muyassar or mukhtasar tafsir al-Quran. Something simple in the beginning. And then when you are proficient, you finish it, you go to the more bigger one or the more complicated one. Understanding the ayat will help you having this reverence in your heart, because when you're listening, you understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. So start by the last juz, juz an. Because this is the one you read a lot in your salah. Read the tafsir for that. Then when you finish, go to juz 29. Try to understand. So when it's always repeated with in front of you in the salah, you are always knowing what does exactly each ayah means. And then you go to al-Baqarah and then go on. Start. This is one sequence. You start whatever you want, but start reading the tafsir. This is another commitment you have toward the Quran. To understand the ayat of Allah, because this Quran has came so that we will apply, not only read and repeat. And as you try to understand, this will also make it easy for you to memorize. When you understand the ayat, especially when you start with juz am, try to read the tafsir and memorize. And then go to good juz 29, and then go to al-Baqarah. And remember that Allah will make it easy for you if you really have the intention and do the effort. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. Which brings us to the next duty we have toward the Quran. مُرَاجَعَةْ مَا نَحْفَرْ. You have to always review what you have memorized. Some of us has the whole juz of 30 is memorized, but they don't repeat it a lot, so they tend to forget it. 29 and 30 memorized, but again they keep forgetting it. The whole Quran memorized, but again they tend to forget it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that you need to keep memorizing the Quran as it's easier than the camel when it's left loose. Will it stay? It will run away. This is how the Quran is. If you don't keep reviewing what you memorize, it's going to be running away. So this is a duty you have toward the Quran. مُرَاجَعَةَ مَا نَحْفَظُ. The sixth and the last duty we have toward the Quran, and this is probably the most important duty, is to apply what we learn from the Quran. Al-amal bil-Quran. The Quran is not there as words and letters that you get only hasanat by reading them. It has came for you to apply. Apply in your daily life. Apply it and learn from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam how to apply it. Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab learned Surah Al-Baqarah or have memorized Surah Al-Baqarah in 8 to 10 years. He was getting every ayah, applying it and moving to the next ayah, applying it and moving to the next ayah. Abdullah Mas'ud was saying that we were memorizing the Quran by 10 by 10, 10 ayat by 10 ayat. We memorized 10 ayat, applied them, and then moved to the next 10 ayat, and so on. The application is the purpose behind the Quran. Imagine that you come on the Day of Judgment, and this Quran is coming to intercede for you. Your kids, your parents, your wife, your friends, everybody left, everybody is running away. And the Quran is coming to you to intercede. It will come to you as shades above your head. On the day when there is no shades, the sun is above the head. How do you get that? By having this Quran as your company in dunya. He will come to accompany you in the day after. And the Prophet ﷺ is talking specifically about Al-Baqarah wa Al-Imran. They will come as shades for you on the Day of Judgment, for those who are applying them in dunya, learning them, reading them, memorizing them, applying them. This is your company. When you need them, when you need them the best. When you need them interceding for you the best. When you have a duty in your job to be done, you have to do it so that you can keep the job and keep getting the payment. What's better job than that? And the payment is the biggest and most rewarding. In dunya and in hereafter, not only in the hereafter. You will see the barakah in your life. So make it as a mission. I have to memorize Al-Baqarah wa Al-Imran. I have to apply them in my daily life. Because this is what I will need the most in the Day of Judgment. Abu Dahdah, when he listened to the ayah, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You will not get the good until you spend for the sake of Allah from the best that you have. The best. Not whatever you don't need, or the things that are worn out, or the whatever is left out. You give it for the sake of Allah. Not like that. The best you have, you give it for the sake of Allah. He had a garden that was one of the best gardens at this time. When he listened to this ayah, so he sees the application. When he listened to this ayah, he told the Prophet ﷺ, I gave it for the sake of Allah. And once he did, he ran back to his garden. He found his kid holding a fruit from the garden. He told him, leave it. It has been already dedicated for the sake of Allah. Not even a single fruit after that. This is how we apply the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how you listen, comprehend, and apply. And so get rewarded in dunya and in the hereafter. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in Surah Al-Furqan, وَقَالَ رَسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. The Prophet ﷺ will come on the Day of Judgment to complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that his people have abandoned this Qur'an. Do we want to be among those whom the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that they have been abandoning the Qur'an? May Allah save us from being among those. This is the Qur'an, the miracle of the Prophet ﷺ. Between our hands, while having the chance to get the best out of it. While you have your breath coming in and out, you still are on this earth, you still have the chance. Before meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will get the blessing in dunya and in the hereafter. This one, is the Qur'an, is the one that will be interceding for you when everybody is running away. And you have the chance now to have this happen to you when you need it the most. The ayat will come into your scale with unlimited numbers by only reading the verses from the Quran in dunya where you have a chance. When you need it the most, to have only one hasana come into your scale so that your scale will go down. You have the chance now, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very generous with us, multiplying the hasanat for whoever you want. But you have to do the effort. Allah made it easy for those who really want to do the effort and go for it. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه غفور رحيم. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واقض عنا شر ما قضيت إنك تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليه إنه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت. تباركت ربنا وتعاليت فلك الحمد على ما قضيت ولك الشكر على ما أعطيت. نستغفرك اللهم من جميع الذنوب والخطايا ونتوب إليك. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحيتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، وانصرنا على من عادانا. اللهم لا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا، واجعل الجنة هي دارنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم بلغنا رمضان واجعله خير رمضان مر علينا يا رب العالمين، واجعلنا من عتقائك من النار في هذا الشهر الكريم يا رب العالمين. وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وأقم الصلاة.